up, people of God? This is Pastor Matt with Believers in Christ Church, the people's pastor. I'm so excited that you have tuned in today to be part of our live stream service. You could have been anywhere else in the world, but you have decided to fellowship with us today. I pray that you continue to get everything that God has for you and that you continue to lock arms with us in fellowship. Now come with us together as we go before the throne of grace. In Jesus' name, amen.
And that your presence might be in this place and might fill the preacher today and fill the speaker, fill the worshipers, fill the musicians, Lord God, allowing us, Lord God, to hear directly from you the message that you have prepared on his heart for us, Lord God. I pray that you will take the word this morning and divide it into all the ways that we need to receive it, even as you did the fish and the loaves, Lord God, that you will allow us to be fed today, Lord God, and walk out changed more into your image, Lord God, so that we can know, Lord God, that all things are possible with you. Father God, we just thank you for keeping us, for keeping our families. We thank you for keeping us and giving us health, Lord God. We thank you for giving us strength, Lord God, in the places of our weakness. We just bless you, Lord God, because you have provided for us a roof over our heads and shoes on our feet and clothes to wear and food on our table. And for those who have not, Lord God, you still have provided them. For you are our shepherd, we lack nothing. You are the great I am. That means you are all that we need. You are all in all. You are our great keeper, our great provider, our great healer, our great redeemer. You are the lover of our soul, Lord God. You are our hope, Lord God. You are peace in the storm, Lord God. And we want to acknowledge you today, Lord God, so that you might direct us in our path, so that you might make that way out of no way that we are waiting for, Lord God. But most importantly, we want to rejoice in the Lord today, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bless you, Lord God. We honor you, Lord God. Even now, hide us behind your cross. Hide us behind your cross, Lord God. Cover us with your blood, Lord Jesus. Cleanse us so that the world might see you and each and every one of us. In Jesus' name.
Open seas, 'cause your love never fails. The chasm is far too wide. I never thought I'd reach the other side. 'Cause your love never fails. You stay the same through the ages. But joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid. Because I know that you love me. Your love never fails.
You make all things
work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. Jesus, you make work together for my good. You stay the same through the ages. 'Cause your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning.
Your love never fails. Amen. All right.
Every time I try to make it on my own, every time I try to stand and start to fall, and all those lonely roads that I have traveled on, there was Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be found, and I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now, there was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing and the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it and couldn't see it, for a man who needs a certain kind of grace, forgiveness at a price I couldn't pay. I'm not perfect, so I thank God every day. There was Jesus. Through the waiting and the searching, through the healing and the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it and couldn't see it, there was Jesus on the mountain, in the valley.
There was Jesus
in the shadow, in the alley.
There was Jesus
in the fire and in the flood.
There was Jesus
always is and always was, in the waiting and the searching, in the healing and the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it and couldn't see it, there was Jesus. There was Jesus.
Working even when we can't see you, Lord God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that your love never fails. We thank you, Lord God, that you've been able to take us through even when we didn't know. That's why we lift your name high today, Lord God. We bless our Lord God today. Those of you watching online, go ahead and write in the comments, Lord, we lift you high. Go ahead and lift your hands to the Lord. The Bible says we lift up our hands unto his holy name. Hallelujah. We lift you high.
Sometimes we want to focus on our problem instead of our God. And this is what you have to say.
Lord, there's only you.
There's only you.
Let all the other names fade away.
See, I don't worship my issue. I worship my God.
He's the way maker.
Jesus, Savior.
He's the promise keeper.
Let all the
He's a miracle worker. And I can testify
that until it was only you,
I couldn't even make my way through, Lord.
And I thank you, Lord. Jesus, take your place. Jesus, take your
many names out there, but Yeshua, that's the best one.
Love.
Say his name. Whatever you're going through, if you need healing, your finances, your home, your family, your children, say his name. All of that will be taken care of. Say his name. It's healing. Praise the Lord. What a wonderful worship this morning. Amen. We're so happy to have you here at Action Church. It's such a beautiful thing for us to come together. And we just praise the Lord to be able to do this as a body. And while I'm on the mic real quick, I just wanted to thank Pastor for allowing me, my family, I don't want to get emotional, but we didn't have a place for our family to have a repast for my aunt who died suddenly. And you opened up your doors to our family free of charge, and we're so thankful and grateful. And we just thank you so much. We thank you so, so much. It was such a blessing for our family during such a difficult time. So just thank you for that. Thank you, Shannon, for coordinating that. I just love you so much. So thank you. Praise God. So we're going to continue with the offering portion of our program today. For those that are tuning in, thank you. You could have been anywhere, but you're tuning in here at Believers in Christ Church. And so we just give you love and thanks for coming and joining in. For those that want to donate via electronic, you can give an offering at $BelieversInChristBIC for Cash App. That's $BelieversInChristBIC. You can also send a donation through PayPal, which is Believers in Christ Academy. Again, that is PayPal at Believers in Christ Academy. You may also mail a check or money order to 121 South Front Street, York Haven, PA, 17370. Again, that is 121 South Front Street, York Haven, PA, 17370. And we also have caping textability. So if you just want to text, telephone number is 717-220-8388. Text the amount you want to give and just hit send. It's that simple. Again, that telephone number is 717-220-8388. Put the amount that you would like to send and just hit send. For all of those that are in-house and you like to give a cash donation, we just ask that you rise to your feet. We have Brother Floyd here at the basket, and we will have Brother Lamar that will usher you all up when it's your time to come up to the basket. So if you want to rise to your feet to give a cash offering. Hallelujah.
Multiply these gifts and the givers. In your precious name we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. And I won't be for you long. I just have some quick announcements. For those that are tuning in, please continue to follow us. Connect with us on our social media platforms, Believers in Christ Church on Facebook and on YouTube. Yes, and please share this stream. Share with everybody. We want people to be able to join in and just be able to enjoy fellowshipping in the Lord. We are still renovating our church. We're so thankful for where God has brought us so far, but we are still in the renovation process of this. So we're looking for a maintenance ministry. So anybody who has skills, we're looking for movers and painters and carpenters as we continue in our renovation. So if you're interested, please contact Pastor Matthew. We are still looking for ushers and bus drivers. And speaking of that, we do have the ability to pick you up. If you need a ride, please contact us. We can pick you up. You can call us here at BIC. That telephone number is 717-814-8832. Or you may email us at bicyork@gmail.com.
We also have our harvest outreach, and we're looking for helpers for that, but we do have a harvest outreach every Saturday. It's such a blessing to be able to give to those in need. We do meet here every Saturday. That's ran by Sister Selena Evans, and we meet Saturday 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. We have our Tuesday Terry prayer every Tuesday. We should be praying every day, but that gives us the opportunity to come together collectively. That is via the telephone. It's a phone conference. It is held led by Denise Ramjour. And if you are interested in that, you may also email us with that interest, again, at bicyork@gmail.com. We also send a reminder, just so you know, it's about to start, and it's at 7:30 a.m. Tuesday mornings. We have our Wednesday Bible study. I look forward to Bible study because that's where you actually grow, when you're getting fed with the Word. And we have a couple of options this month. So we have the Armor of God, which is led by Sister Vanessa on Mondays at 6:30. That is being held via Zoom. And also they are meeting in person at Third Space Coffee House down the road here. So if you don't want to come out, that's okay. We do have a Zoom link if you're interested in signing up for that. And we're also still meeting on Wednesdays via Zoom at 6:30 with Brother Patrick, who is also a part of Common Grounds Church. We have our Kingdom-Minded Men's Meeting that's held every second Monday of the month. If you are interested in that, please notify Pastor Matthew with your interest. Right now, they're currently doing a blanket and sock drive, and they are accepting any donations until Sunday, December 20th. So that's the Sunday before Christmas. If you're interested, please contact Pastor Matt with your donation for socks and blankets. We're also excited about our upcoming skit that we're doing for our Christmas program. We're really working hard on pulling this together. We still have openings if anyone is interested. You don't have to be a member here at Believers in Christ, but if you know anyone, any children who are interested in participating, please come out. We have a rehearsal this Saturday at noon. You can also contact Sister Vanessa for some information for that. And also, any young men that are interested in signing up for our BOSS programs, this is really exciting. So BOSS stands for Boys Overcoming Systematic Sin. It's a wonderful program that Pastor has started along with my husband, Charles. And you can sign up this week. We need a head count if you're interested. There will be some fellowship this Saturday, November 14th at 6 p.m. If you know any young men that may be interested, there's going to be laser tag and pizza. It's going to be a really fun time, but we do need you to sign up. We have a sign-up sheet right out in the entrance area when you first walk in. You can sign your name. And also, if you would need transportation, we can provide that. All we need is for you to contact us on those telephone numbers that I stated earlier. And that will be it for announcements this morning. If you want to come up to announce the MIND team.
Amen. Amen. Give a hand for LaShay Bennett. She does so much, and we are so thankful for all that the Lord has given us the opportunity to do. We try to engage every person. So if you like something you heard and you want to be a part of it, it's open to everyone. This is a community here. But I wanted us, before we heard the preached word from Pastor Dawn, to sit down and really enjoy the word of God in another way offered to us. We have a team called ASAP Mime, always spiritually abounding in praise. They mime by action and sign language the word of God via song. And we want you to see and feel how the Lord can minister to you, even if you can't hear a word. Amen. So we can see the word of God being performed. So I'm just going to ask you all to put your hands together and introduce. And I'm introducing ASAP Mime. Come on up to the stage.
Thank you, Lord. myself in the mirror. Religion looking back at me. I threw my hands in the air, and the law arrested me. Girl interrupted. I needed to break out and get freedom. One bad decision after the next, just getting by.
Yeah, come on now. We can keep praising the Lord after that. Come on now. We can keep praising the Lord after that. I mean, you got two young ladies. They could be doing a whole lot of other stuff. But they came here to the house of the Lord to worship God today. So I just think that because God kept them, that we got a reason to praise the Lord. Because they could be anywhere doing God knows what with God knows who. But they took their bodies and worshiped the Lord with their crown of their head to the soles of their feet. Somebody praise the Lord with me today. You ain't got to be shy. Come on now, praise the Lord with me today. Come on now. Somebody praise the Lord with me today. Somebody praise the Lord with me today. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. He is worthy to be praised. Hallelujah, Jesus. I thank you, Lord. 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 Hallelujah, Jesus. I thank you, Lord. Because you are worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. You are the Elohim. You are the Elohim. You are God above all gods. You are name above all names. Oh, hallelujah. I thank you, Jesus. You are the El Shaddai. Oh, praise the Lord, the Almighty. Oh, praise God. We bless your name, God. All we know how to do is bless your name. Praise the Lord. You brought us from death to life that we may worship you. Oh, praise the Lord with me today. See, I get blessed when I see our young people doing stuff. I get blessed because I think about what I was doing at their age. I wasn't in the church at their age. At their age, I was trying to hide stuff from my parents. At their age, I was on the block doing things I had no reason doing, and I didn't even have to do. Oh, but praise the Lord. When we got young people that want to worship God, oh, praise the Lord. The word says, and a child shall lead them. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. I'm Pastor Matt, by the way. Praise the Lord. Amen. I'm super excited, praise God, to be here with the people of God today. Amen. It looks so beautiful in here today with the people of God. I mean, just take a look around. Just pause for a second. See, I had a football coach that used to tell me, he said, don't let the moment be too big for you. That sometimes you got to seize the moment. I remember we were playing a team that was undefeated the year before, and we were playing them the first game of the season, and the coach said, seize the moment. He said, don't let the moment get too big for you. Don't let it pass you and look back on it. Seize the moment. Well, praise the Lord. A whole lot of stuff been going on in the country lately. A whole lot of stuff been going on. People been trying to divide the church. People been trying to separate the church. People been trying to say things can't go right within a church, things can't go right within a country. But pause, I ain't gonna let y'all miss this moment. I ain't gonna let y'all miss the moment. Just look around. Just do a 360. Because I don't wanna let you miss the moment. Praise the Lord. Paul was obsessed with the unity of the church. He was obsessed with it. We're gonna talk about that next week. Obsessed with the unity of the church. Why? Because the church was, it was a mixture of Jew and Gentiles. And a lot of them had different backgrounds. You go to different cultural areas. When they would go to the church at Thessalonica, it was different. It might have been a little different than the church of Colossae. They had different cultural things, but at the end of the day, Jesus Christ reigns. Jesus Christ reigns. Praise the Lord. And I'm excited to have Action Church here with us. You all mean so much to us. Y'all mean so much to us. We would not be in this building if it wasn't for Action Church. We wouldn't be here. It's that simple. So we thank you all. Praise the Lord. And my friend Pastor Dan here as well. Pastor Dan from Common Ground, my brother. That's my brother right there. And they have been awesome and awesome support of brothers and sisters in the Lord as well. But I'm just excited about what God is doing. And I'm going to bring up Pastor Don in just a sec, but I just wanted to stand here for a second, just absorb what God is doing. Because even when you look at, you know, they talk a lot about lately now, I guess since yesterday, about healing. They talking about a man that can heal the land. And I know we got some issues in this country. No country is perfect. But I don't know how you could look to a man to heal a nation. I don't know how you could look to a man to make a nation great.
Because somewhere in the Bible it says, if my people, somewhere in the word it tells me, if my people, so watch this now. It doesn't mean it has to be all people. He said, if my people, who are his people, well, the world tells us that those, praise the Lord, that have accepted Jesus Christ have become sons and daughters of the Most High. So it don't take all people. But God said, if my people who are called by my name, whoa, humble themselves and pray, then I will hear from heaven and heal their land. If they will humble themselves and pray, turn from their wicked ways, seek my face, then I will hear from heaven and heal their land. Oh, somebody praise the Lord with me today. We can't put our faith in no man. We can't put our faith in man. We got to put our faith in Jesus Christ. He's the healer. Praise the Lord. He healed at the pool of Bethesda. He healed in the temple. He heals today. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So I'm just excited. I'm just excited, man, to be here and to worship with us. And I'm going to get out of the way right now and bring up my good brother, Pastor Don, to share the word with us. This is my brother, man. Do y'all see the family resemblance? Y'all see the family resemblance? This is my brother right here. And I am excited for him to bring the word here today.
Am I on here? Well, thank you all. That feels about right. Pastor Matt just lightened up the room. And I'm going to talk to you about my busted iPhone. Yeah. So thank you all. I want to talk to you about recharging today. I think we need to recharge. I feel it. I think November, man, if we don't recharge, I don't know what we're going to do for 2021. I keep hearing people say, oh, it's going to be, you know, a new year. It is, but we're still part of it. So here's the thing about it. I've been thinking about recharging all week because I got a 2-year-old iPhone. Anybody else have a 2-year-old iPhone? That's about when it starts, right? When you get it, it's great. This is a 10. Remember when the 10 came out and we were all excited? I felt good about it. I would take it out and people would go, how do you like it? And I would talk about it like I invented it, right? You know, I would say, yeah, I like this feature and no button. And now it's like it still works, but the screen is cracked. And I think about plugging it in all the time. Like I plug it in the car because it's down, and I plug it in when I get up in the next room, and I plug it in the couch. We got one of those couches with the where you plug it in the side because it never ever seems to hold its charge. And so having a 2-year-old iPhone kind of does that. Like you think about, I need to recharge because I'm not going to make it through the day. And I'll also say, like, having a 52-year-old body, same thing. Like, I feel like I'm going to have to recharge to make it through the day. You know, it still works. There's some things that are cracked, but you got to recharge, which I'm pretty good at. I can fall asleep at a stoplight now. Like, I'm a professional napper at 52. So, but here's the thing I want to talk to you about this morning. I want to talk to you about recharging your soul. Because I think we got to do that. And if I look at 2020, I was thinking, I look at 2020, like any one of the things we've been through this year would drain you, right? And I'm not even sure I can hit everything on the list. We got COVID. We've got all sorts of unrest. We had an election that was just crazy. And then we had unrest. And we've got social media, and we're locked in our houses part of that time, just going crazy, and it's draining. And so we got to figure out a way to recharge our souls. Now, I've been thinking about that a lot because I felt down. I felt drained. And then I realized something, and I want to read something to you that you may have heard before, but I realized that I've been reading something my whole life in the Bible, and I've been reading it wrong, I think. If you want to turn to Philippians 4, some of you memorize this, probably many of you know this, and I'm reading from the New Living, but Philippians 4:4 says this. It says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. And let your gentleness be evident to all, for the Lord is near. And do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." And finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. And then he says, whatever you've learned or received or heard from me or seen from me, put into practice, and may the God of peace be with you. Now, here's the way I read it. I read that like a list, because I like tasks. I like doing tasks. In fact, when I play Among Us, I don't want to be the imposter, because I want to do the tasks, right? Like, I want to fix the ship. That's who I am. I like connecting the wires. You know, we got some Among Us players here, I can see. But I like doing the tasks. And so when I read this in Scripture, I read it like a list, like a to-do list. Like, okay, rejoice. And then he said, again, I say rejoice. And then remember, God is watching, and pray about stuff. Okay, I'm a Christian. I'll do that. And think good thoughts. And I'm not complaining about any one of these things, because I think they're right. And obey the Bible, and then do all the other stuff on your list that day. Now here's the problem with that. It felt like that being a Christian, that doing all those things on the list, that rejoicing and then rejoicing again, you're just going to have to sort of get up earlier in the morning and do more stuff than ordinary people. Now here's the problem with that. I don't think that's what he was saying. I don't think Paul was like giving us extra tasks. I don't think Paul's like, hey, rejoice, and then make sure you rejoice again. And then, you know God is watching, and then think about things. See, here's what I think, and I've sort of changed this in my mind, and I'll tell you why in a second. But I think what Paul was saying is, when he's saying rejoice, and again I say rejoice, we should change that into recharge. And again I say recharge, because that makes a little more sense, doesn't it? Because the joy of the Lord is what? It's our strength, right? So what Paul was saying is, brothers, you got to recharge, and I'm saying it again to you, recharge. And it's funny, because you and I would never, ever, especially if you got a 2-year-old busted iPhone like I do, you would never say like, well, I'm going to save a little time by not recharging today, would you? You're not going to make it through. And the same is true about rejoicing. See, if we don't rejoice, if we don't recharge, we're not going to make it through. Now, here's what really captivated me about this, is because I was studying and I was like, well, where is rejoicing most talked about in the Bible? And it's the Psalms, right? Like, obviously, it's in the Psalms. 195 times King David says that you should rejoice, or he was rejoicing. Now, here's the thing I love about David, is like, David was a tough guy. Any football players that got to have a football in your yearbook photo, like, that's cool. Like, I wasn't that guy. I had a letterman for like, or a letter, I never even got the jacket for like throwing shot put. I was not sporty in high school, and you don't take a shot put with you to your yearbook. But I know some of you probably had a football in your yearbook picture, or a baseball bat, or a batter's helmet, and it's cool. Chicks dig that. I wish I would have had that. I didn't have that. I just looked like this. But here's the thing. David, in his yearbook photo, he's got the head of Goliath. Chicks dig that. You know what I'm saying? Like, David had a giant's head that he decapitated, and a giant, you know, like, so that's David. David's a tough guy. You know, it seems like most of the guys I know are chicks, and like, David is not that. But yet David's talking about rejoicing. Now, David also, I mean, you go, well, you ought to see my wedding party. It was amazing. David killed 200 Philistines as a gift to his father-in-law. That's the kind of guy David is, right? Like, he doesn't mess around, but he talks more about rejoicing than anybody in the Bible. And you know what I think that was? I think that was David living such an extreme life. Let me read this to you. This is from Psalm 104:33. He says, I will sing to the Lord as long as I live, and I will praise my God to my last breath. May all my thoughts be pleasing to him. And then he says, for I what? I rejoice in the Lord. I recharge in the Lord. See, I think David had to recharge because of the extreme life he lived. His father-in-law is the king of Israel and is trying to kill him the whole time. You know, I mean, he's living a life you and I can only imagine. And so he has to recharge more. So he says, rejoice, rejoice, rejoice. So I was like feeling all good about that. And we're going to talk about Psalms at Action Church all month. And I was super excited about that. And then Jesus sort of ruined my week, which Jesus ruining your plans is pretty much the best thing you can do, because I remembered something that I hadn't remembered. And I want to share it with you this morning, is that Jesus actually told his followers that they shouldn't rejoice in something. And I was like, well, that kind of messes up my whole deal of talking to everybody about rejoice, rejoice. It's recharging. Our joy of the Lord is our strength, so we should recharge. And then Jesus sort of yelled at his followers for rejoicing about the wrong thing. And I was like, well, that's a problem. So, and had an interesting thing with Pastor Matt. I called Pastor Matt, was it Friday? And we were talking about, like, I was just sort of pre-preaching. That's what preachers do. We call it pre-preaching, where we're just like, I want to tell you what I'm going to talk about. And I started talking about this scripture, and he goes, wait a minute, are you talking about Luke 10? And he said he was sitting here in this room with that open, looking at the same thing, and I kind of got chills, and I went, okay, I get it. We're supposed to talk about that. And now you and I aren't, I mean, that sounds like a preacher story, but we know that's true. But let me read something from Luke chapter 10, and you can read it too. I'm going to start in verse 17. But this is a story about Jesus sending out 72 disciples to heal people, to cast out demons, to preach the word of God. Like, these are chosen people. And he sends them out, and he sends them on a mission, and he tells them, like, don't take anything with you. Don't make any plans. Just go out. And what he wants them to do is learn the power of God. Like, they're going to help people, but really they're learning. So he sends them out, and listen to this when they come back. In verse 17 of Luke 10, it says this, when the 72 disciples returned, they joyfully reported to him, Lord, even the demons obey us when we use your name. Yes, he told them. So he's like, yes, I agree. He said, I saw Satan fall from heaven like lightning, and look, I have given you authority over all the power of the enemy, and you can walk among snakes and scorpions and crush them, and don't worry. Like, you're like, oh no, it's going to be one of those guys. That's not where I'm going with this morning. I do have a box of snakes, though. I really don't. He says, look, I have given you authority over the power of the enemy, and you can walk among the snakes and the scorpions and crush them, and nothing will injure you. But in verse 20, he says this, and check this out. He says, don't rejoice because evil spirits obey you, but rejoice because your names are registered in heaven. And I have a question for you that I was thinking about this week. Why would Jesus say that? Why would Jesus be a buzzkill? Like, that's not Jesus. Like, they're all excited, right? Like, they're super excited. Like, you can't believe this, Jesus, which is kind of funny to say to Jesus, right? Like, you'd never guess what happened. But they come back and they go, we healed people. They're saying, we healed people, and we saw people come to you, and we saw people turn and follow. They're with us now. Like, they followed, and we saw miracles happen, and the demons, we were driving out demons in your name. Like, it was so amazing. And he's like, don't rejoice in that. You should rejoice because your names are written in heaven. And it makes you wonder, like, why would Jesus sort of kill the mood, right? Because Jesus is not that kind of guy. See, here's the thing I know about Jesus, and you should know about Jesus. People who are nothing like Jesus like Jesus. Jesus got invited to parties. I mean, think about it. Like, the first thing we know about Jesus is he was invited to a wedding and he turned water into wine. Jesus was popular and fun, right? You get that? Like, it's funny because guys who have a reputation, now Jesus was sinless, and so Jesus wasn't a drunkard and a, you know, but he had a reputation as being a drunkard and a friend of sinners because Jesus was a lot of fun. Here's how I know it, because every friend you have that's a drunkard and a friend of sinners, they're fun. Now, they're dangerous, man, right? Like, everybody has a drunk Uncle Harold, right? I had a drunk Uncle Harold. And my parents, I'm the son, believe it or not, I'm the son of a Baptist minister, and they, you know, I don't even think they liked vanilla because it had alcohol in it. But here's, well, actually we did. We like vanilla because we're from the Midwest. But they would always warn us about our Uncle Harold because he was not a Christian and he was drunk. And you know what we learned as little preacher's kids? He was so much fun. Oh, my goodness. Like, you know, he was the guy who would, like, make pancakes at 3 in the morning all lit up, and we'd watch cowboy movies. So I don't know how that helped us because it honestly made us think that that was the way to live. And we tried it for a little while. It didn't work well, but I'm telling you, I think Mom and Dad were right. But here's the thing. Jesus had that reputation. Jesus was invited to parties. Jesus was so much fun. But yet his people come back, and he's like, guys, settle a little bit, man. I don't want you to rejoice about that. And it's kind of weird because you kind of go, well, why not recharge when things are going well? Why not recharge when people are getting healed? Why not recharge when demons, can you imagine that? Like, demons are leaving people because of God's power. I mean, it's amazing. And he's like, chill a little, man. That's, don't rejoice in that. And here's the thing, honestly, there's nothing more sort of recharging and rejoicing than when miracles happen, right? Have you ever been around a miracle? I have. I've seen miracles happen. They're real. They're real. Our spiritual mentor, Pastor Keith and Millie Grahams, I was a kid wandering far away from God, even though I was a pastor's son. I'll tell you what kind of kid I was. I was the kind of kid who called, this is before caller ID, thankfully. I would call my mom drunk at about 2 in the morning to make sure the rapture hadn't happened. You know, I figured if Mom was there, I'd be okay for another day. But in that, I'm not proud of it. But then I met my wife-to-be, and it was funny because I was a bad influence on her, you know? But we had these friends, Pastor Keith and Millie of a really, you know, successful Assembly of God church there in Cape Girardeau, Missouri. And you know what they did for us? They just loved us and accepted us. That's always inspired me. Because here we're like two sinful kids, like, living together, and she was divorced and had a son, and it was like we were just the, and this is in the 80s in Missouri, so this is not cool, I'm telling you. And you know what? They had us in our home. They loved us. They cared for us. They treated us like family. And because of that, they loved us into the kingdom. Like, we're here today. I'm talking to you here today, not because, you know, I'm a pastor's son, but because another pastor loved me when I was far away from God. Now, here's the thing, and keep in mind, like, you could have a legacy like that, and it's that simple, like just loving someone far from God and bringing them back. But here's the thing, he was diagnosed with cancer. And it was a Pentecostal Assembly of God church in the middle of Missouri, and we prayed. Like, they had prayer meetings, they anointed him with oil, and they prayed, and that cancer was gone. It was. We saw him healed. Like, the doctor said, it was here, and it's not here anymore. And I remember that church rejoicing. I still remember those moments. Like, and so it's hard for me to imagine why a Jesus would say to his followers, don't let that be where you get your recharging. Because it is so exciting when you see miracles happen, when you see lives change, right? Like, there's nothing better. But here's the thing I have to tell you this morning. and I don't want to, and you're not going to like it. But sometimes here on earth, the demons win. And sometimes here on earth, you pray and you pray and you pray, and people don't get healed. And sometimes here on earth, it looks like good is never going to triumph. And it seems like you're a sucker if you believe in it. Now here's the thing. See, what I think Jesus was warning us about, and if you think, well, that's just because we're not very good at it, guess what? I want to remind you that Jesus' disciples weren't very good at driving out demons either. Let me read this to you real quick before we go on. In Matthew 17, check this out. Imagine this. It says, at the foot of the mountain, a large crowd was waiting for them. And a man came and knelt before Jesus and said, Lord, have mercy on my son. He has seizures and he suffers horribly and he often falls into the fire or into the water. Don't let this be a story. Let this be a story about a kid if you have kids. And then the man says, so I brought him to your disciples, but they couldn't heal him. These are the same group of people that went out and healed people and saw demons leave, but they couldn't heal this guy. And Jesus said, Jesus was fun, but I forgot to mention, he was way tougher than David because he said, you faithless and corrupt people, how long must I deal with you? Wow. How long must I put up with you? Bring the boy to me. And Jesus rebuked the demon in the boy, and it left him. And from that moment, the boy was well. And afterwards, the disciples asked Jesus privately. I bet they did. I bet they didn't raise their hand. They're like, Master. And then they said, why couldn't we cast out that demon? And you know what Jesus said to them? He said, you don't have enough faith. I tell you the truth, if you have faith even as small as a mustard seed, you would say to this mountain, it would be moved and it would turn away. Now here's the thing. That's just one example. There's another example in Mark 9 where he said, and this is probably the toughest thing you could hear from Jesus. They said, why couldn't we heal? Why couldn't we drive that demon out? He goes, it takes prayer and fasting. Right? Like, ooh, wow. Guess we should have thought of that. Here's another story that I'm just probably reading it because I think it's funny. It's from Acts 19. It's the sons of Sceva. It says, now God gave Paul the power to perform unusual miracles. And when handkerchiefs or aprons had merely touched his skin and were placed on sick people, they were healed of their diseases and evil spirits were expelled. And a group of Jews was traveling from town to town casting out evil spirits. And they tried to use the name of the Lord Jesus as an incantation, saying, I command you in the name of Jesus, whom Paul preaches, to come out. And then seven sons of Sceva, a leading priest, were doing this. But one time when they tried it, the evil spirit replied, I know Jesus and I know Paul, but who are you? And the man with the evil spirit leaped on them and overpowered them and attacked them with such violence that they fled the house naked and bruised, which is the funniest thing I've ever read in Acts. But here's the thing about it. Back then and today, sometimes, here on earth, not as it is in heaven, but here on earth, sometimes the demons win. And sometimes the person you pray for doesn't get healed. And sometimes the evil triumphs for a little while. Let me tell you another story about my mentor, Pastor Keith Grahams. About 7 years later, he got cancer again. And we prayed. And we fasted, and we anointed him with oil, and we had faith. And we sat by his bedside as he died. But God was no less in control than he was 7 years before, right? And so if you and I sort of rejoice when things are going well, rejoice when demons are being driven out and miracles are happening and God's healing people, and that's awesome, then we only sort of recharge when things are good. And that's not even when we really need it, right? John Lennon said this. Jerry's going to hate me, but he knows I'm not a fan of John Lennon, but I do like this. Sorry. He said, in the end, and he stole this from an Indian proverb, but he said, in the end, it will be okay. And if it's not okay, it's not the end. And that's the story of Christianity, really. Think about it, right? That's what Jesus was saying. He's like, it's great that you had a great outing. And by the way, guys, that was my plan. Like, I wanted you to see the power of God. But don't let your rejoicing be just when things are going well. Because then you're only going to be able to recharge when things are going well. And boy, we know that's not always the case, is it? I'm so glad he said that, because a little while later they were sort of, what, waiting in an upper room, and Jesus was gone, they thought, and there was just a few of them left, and they're sort of just waiting for the authorities to arrest them. There would have been no rejoicing that night, right? And no recharging. Let me read you something Paul said, and you could look it up in Colossians chapter 3. He said, since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven. How's that? Where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. And think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth, for you died to this life, and your real life is hidden with Christ in God. See, that's what I want to leave you with this morning. I want to caution you, because I think God wants to caution us. And it's funny, because I never intended to make that part of this recharge series, but I realized, like, oh, thank you, Jesus, for sort of ruining my plans. Because it's easy to rejoice and recharge when things are wonderful. Like, this is a great day. I look around. Let me tell you something. This is the first time I've been in this building since it was... I mean, it's not finished, and it won't be finished for years, because you guys are going to keep building and building, expanding. But since it was this, and this is amazing. In fact, I had to tell Action Church people, this is what a real church looks like. They have windows and comfortable seats. Like, we've met in a theater and a bar and a nightclub and another bar. Like, we've had windows. No, I don't think we've ever had. Yeah, I did. We've had windows or comfortable seats. Never the same at the same time. Now we have no windows and no comfortable seats, and it's awesome. But here's the thing. I saw this place before it was finished, right? Because I sat here with Pastor Matt over there on one of those big, long, curved pews while this was piled with trash, and he explained it to me. Like, he had a vision for what this place would be, and so I'm not surprised this morning. Because it was already a reality back then. It just hadn't happened yet. Right? Now, bear in mind, I know what it must have taken to do this. You guys worked pretty hard, right? So it wasn't like you just go, let's wait for the reality. If you do that, nothing's going to happen, trust me. But see, there are realities that just haven't happened yet. I'm standing in one. I can't believe I'm here talking to you. This is amazing, but I can believe it because I've seen it, and you did it, and God did it, right? So I want to leave you. I want to just kind of like give you some realities from heaven in the middle of a very weird year, a draining year, a draining time. And so if you wanted to be one of those people that only rejoiced when things are going well, when your bank account is fat, you know, when the stock market's up, and when you're certain that everything's going to be okay, well, it wouldn't be a very rejoicing time this year. You know, I'm 52 years old, and about 72 times this year I was just like, I don't know, I've never seen this. You know, it's so weird, because the older you get, the more stuff you go, seen it, done it. I'm just like, no clue, guys. I have no idea what's going to happen next. This is crazy. But I want to read to you just a few verses from Psalms 89 this morning. And I want you to go back maybe this week and read Psalms 89. Now, this is not a song of Psalm of David. This is a cover tune from Psalms.
This is a psalm about David. But in verse 13, it says this. And I want you to think about this in light of this is reality. It just hasn't happened yet. It says, powerful is your arm and strong is your hand. And your right hand is lifted high in glorious strength. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. And unfailing love and truth walk before you as attendants. Happy are those who hear the joyful call of worship, for they will walk in the light of your presence, Lord. They rejoice all day long in your wonderful reputation. They exult in your righteousness. You are their glorious strength, and it pleases you to make us strong. Yes, our protection comes from the Lord, and he, the Holy One of Israel, has given us our king. Now, here's the thing. They were talking about David, but he's given us a king as well.
So I want to think about that just a little bit, like
how we could recharge in that. Powerful is your arm and strong is your hand. Easy to forget, isn't it? The God who always wins. When here in this life, sometimes you pray and someone's not healed. And sometimes it seems that the darkness is gaining ground. But I just want to remind you of something here. And this is why our world is so messed up. Because it says righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Unfailing love and truth walk as your attendants. Now here's the thing. The best our culture can offer is righteousness or justice. Love or truth. We go righteousness. We can do the right thing. We can make some rules. We'll follow them. We'll follow those rules. We're going to be right. But it doesn't mean there's justice for everybody, does it? Or we can go, we can get justice, but we're going to have to break some heads. We can get justice, and we're going to have to do some wrong things. We get justice, but we may have to harm a few innocent people to get that justice. See, the best our culture can offer is righteousness or justice, love or truth, right? Because you know this from your family. Because if you love them, you should tell them the truth, but as soon as you tell them the truth and go, man, that's harmful. God doesn't want you to do that because it's going to harm you. That's sin. They go, well, you hate me. That's hateful. So the best we can do in our culture is love or truth, righteousness or justice. And the truth is, God's plan for this world when he remakes it is righteousness and justice, love and truth. And listen to what it says. It says, happy are those who hear the joyful call to worship. We're not going to have to wake people up. We're not going to have to send out text messages. We're not going to go, hey, make sure we come here at 10:30 because we're excited to come. And notice what it says. They rejoice all day long in God's wonderful reputation. And you know what, guys? I don't know where you're at with the election. It's funny, Action Church, we've got all kinds of people. I don't know if you voted for Joe Biden or you voted for Donald Trump. And the Bible says for Christians, as brothers and sisters, we're supposed to rejoice with those who rejoice and mourn with those who mourn. So this morning, if you voted for President-elect Biden, I'm going to rejoice with you for a couple minutes. And if you voted for Donald Trump, President Trump, I'll mourn with you for a couple minutes. And then I'm going to get back to life. But here's the thing I want you to know. Here's the thing I want you to know. This stuff, righteousness and justice and love and truth, that wasn't on the ballot on either side. We were never going to get that. But but it's reality. It's just not here yet. Right? So I want to wrap this up, and I just want to remind you this week, wherever you're at in life. And here's the thing. I hope you rejoice this week just because things are awesome. That would be great. Like if everybody's like, I got to tell you, Don, I don't know what you were talking about that bad stuff. It was fantastic. I was dancing. Awesome. I hope that's the case. But Jesus, who was the most fun, who loved his people more than you and I could even imagine, he cautioned them. He goes, hey. Not that that's bad. Like, he wasn't trying to stop their celebration because they were winning. But he was like, rejoice because your names are registered in heaven, because that is so much freaking better. Right? So I want to pray with you, and I'm going to have Pastor Matt come up here, and we're going to sort of carry out to a day when it seemed like everything bad was happening. To a day when it seemed like evil was definitely going to win. Right, Pastor Matt? But I want to just tell you, recharge in the Lord. And again, I say recharge. And can I pray with them? I'd just like to pray over them. Dear Jesus, God, we rejoice in you. And God, I'm so, so grateful to see you at work. To see you in the faces of my brothers and sisters. To see you in their love for each other and for family from across town. And God, I'm so grateful to see your power in this building. That is just a miracle that we're standing in it right now. But God, none of that compares to the reality that's coming. God, let that joy be our strength on the worst day, when people aren't being healed that we're praying for and the demons seem to be winning. Because you are our hope, you are our salvation, and we will rejoice in you. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Brother. Thank you, Brother. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. What an awesome, awesome word. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap for that word from the man of God. Hallelujah. What an awesome word. Rejoice always. Paul said rejoice. And I think we have much to rejoice about. I mean, just look around at the body of Christ. The body of Christ is stronger than ever. The body of Christ ain't going nowhere. And this is just emblematic of how awesome it is when people come to Christ. Because Christ supersedes all, everything that you can think of. Our relationship with Christ supersedes it, and he brings us together. And in that, we can rejoice. It doesn't matter who's sitting in the White House, because we know who's sitting on a throne in heaven. I say we rejoice in that. We can rejoice in that because God is worthy. We're going to go to a time of communion. Amen. We're going to partake in communion together. I'm going to ask the elders to come up, and I'm also going to ask Pastor Don and Pastor Dan to come up as well, to help serve. I need my Bible. Can you grab my Bible for me real quick, Mama? So communion is an awesome time to sit at the Lord's table. And I believe that today is a great time to do this because of the unity that is being expressed here in the body of Christ. That we can all go to the Lord's table together in unity, and we can rejoice in his death and his resurrection. I'm going to read 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And the word of God reads, "Now in giving this instruction, I do not praise you, since you come together not for the better, but for the worse. For to begin with, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you. And in part, I believe it. Indeed, it is necessary that there be factions among you, so that those who are approved may be recognized among you. When you come together, then, it is not to eat the Lord's supper, for at the meal each one eats his own supper. So one person is hungry while another gets drunk. Don't you have homes in which to eat and drink? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What should I say to you? Should I praise you? I do not praise you in this matter. For I received from the Lord what I also passed to you. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord took bread, and when he had given thanks, broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he also took the cup after supper and said, 'This cup is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink in remembrance of me.' But as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sin against the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself in this way. Let him eat the bread and drink from the cup. For whoever eats and drinks recognizing the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. This is why many are sick and ill among you, and many have fallen asleep. If we were properly judging ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that we may not be condemned with the world. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, when you come together to eat, welcome one another. If anyone is hungry, we should eat at home, so that when you gather together, you will not come under judgment. I will give instructions about other matters whenever I come." So praise the Lord. Communion is a time between you and the Lord. It is not up to somebody to decide for you to have communion or not. But I would caution everyone to pause for a moment, self-reflect, and go before the Lord. And if you are willing at that moment to partake in the Lord's Supper, the table is spread and the feast is open. And we would ask you to come from the back to the, you just follow the ushers as I direct you. Thank you, Brother Floyd.
Praise the Lord.
Man, let me tell you something. Y'all look beautiful, man. Let me tell you something. The kingdom of heaven, I believe it's in Revelation 9, John was raptured to heaven. And he said he saw people from all nations worshiping the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Woo! Praise the Lord. Woo! Jesus. Woo. On that fateful night, at that Passover Seder, Jesus, he took the bread and he broke it. He said, "This is my body, which has been broken. This is my body, which has been broken for you. As often as you eat this, you show forth my death and my suffering. Take, eat, all of it." After supper, Jesus took the cup. He blessed it and gave thanks. And he said, "This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new covenant. As often as you do this, you do show forth my death and my suffering. Drink all of it in Jesus' name." Praise the Lord. The altar is open. If you desire prayer, if you desire that place where you can rejoice, if you desire that sincere spirit of wanting to just rejoice in the Lord, the altar is open unto you. Praise the Lord. If you don't know Jesus Christ, praise God. If you don't know Jesus Christ, praise the Lord. The altar is open unto you. If you want to know what it's like to not have burdens anymore, if you want to know what it's like to have peace, I'm going to ask the altar team to come up. If you want to know what it's like to be part of the household of the faithful, praise the Lord. The altar is open unto you today. Praise the Lord. We're going to open up the altar. If you desire prayer, thank you.
Hallelujah. expressions on each day. Won't you come down? 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 Won't you come down and
Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Can everybody just stand to their feet? I just want to thank the Lord for this opportunity to allow his body to dwell in unity. Father, we thank you for the unity in the body. We thank you, Lord, that no matter what's going on outside and around us, oh God, that we can show forth the glory of Jesus Christ. Father God, I pray for every home represented here today. I pray for, oh God, for every home represented here that is being prayed for, even though they might not be here. I pray for every lost soul in this region, oh God, to come to the understanding of Jesus Christ. Lord God, I thank you for these men of God that have locked arms with us here today, Lord. I pray for Action Church, oh God. I pray that you begin to expand the borders, oh God. I pray, oh God, right now in the name of Jesus, oh God. Oh God, that you expand the borders, oh God. That you expand the footprint, oh God. I see souls coming in the Action Church doors, oh God. I thank you for the leadership of Action Church, oh God. I thank you, Lord God, that they've been so faithful. I thank you, Lord, that when it looked like closing the doors is the only option, that, Lord, you said, I'm going to keep the doors open. Father, I pray right now for the man of God that you continue to build him up, continue to give him vision, continue to let him operate in wisdom, Lord. I pray for Pastor Dan. I pray for Common Ground and Third Space, that, Lord, that you begin to open up their borders, oh God. Lord God, that you bring the volunteers in, Lord God, so that they can be open all every day, oh God, as a place of ministry to manufacture, oh God, saints that can go out and be discipled, oh God. I pray for the man of God. I pray that you give him boldness and confidence to walk in the land of the living. God, anoint these three ministries, Lord, that have gathered here under the auspice of your Holy Spirit. Father, we are one. One in spirit. We might operate in different locations or operate in different ways, but your spirit is ever present. We honor you today, Lord, and we thank you in Jesus' name. If you agree with me, somebody say amen, amen, and amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We're going to dismiss right from here. If there's nothing else, I pray the Lord bless you and keep you. I pray the Lord lift up his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. I pray the Lord lift up his countenance to shine upon you and grant you peace. That the Lord God of peace will give you peace always and in everything. In Jesus' name. Go and be a blessing. Tell someone that you love them. In Jesus' name. Amen.